Hey, we're Bastille or Bastille. You're watching Emma. That's doing so well. I've got a little card and everything. One sentence. MSN exclusives.
Hi, we're Bastille and you're watching MSN exclusives.
So the backstory of the video was Dan is a prime athlete, we discovered. So this required showcasing. So yeah, we thought we'd base a video around Dan running.
Yeah. I got really, when we were like planning the video, I got really into the idea of it being this sort of slightly post-apocalyptic thing that was sort of gestured towards, you know, something like some sort of big dramatic event, like obviously like a volcano erupting, but not something else. And so I got really into the idea and the script was awesome and I just massively overlooked the fact that I had to play the lead character. So suddenly I was on the set of this video and they were like, right, so now your motivation is you're furious and you're scared and like, and now kick the car. And I had to like start kicking and smacking this poor unsuspecting car in the middle of a desert. And it was from that moment onwards, the next 2 days of my life, I was like, oh, I'm acting, this is awful. And I'm running, which I also can't do. And it's potentially gonna be seen by a few people.
It's a matter of time until Hollywood comes calling, I feel. Having seen that.
Well, yeah. David Lynch, right? Didn't you meet him? One of you met him recently?
Yeah, I met him.
I'm sorry, I had to do it. There it is. That's right, fine. Off the beginning, the David Lynch thing.
Yeah, no, we did a remix of one of his songs off his new album, which was insane to be able to do. And then off the back of that, when we were in Los Angeles, back in July, ended up going to his studio house thing and just hanging out for an hour and having some coffee.
Nice.
Which was wicked.
It was awesome. Well, even the cover of the record, I was just telling you guys, it kind of reminds me of Lost Highway. And I was obsessed with that soundtrack. Back when people still bought the actual CD soundtrack, remember those days? Yeah. And the Pumpkins had the song Eye on it, and I just loved that tune. And what's interesting about this record, too, is I like the little film thing at the bottom, but... So, Weight of Living Part 1 is not officially on here, but it's like, it's at the end, right, nonetheless? Yeah. So, Weight of Living Part 2 kind of is in the middle of the record. Part 1 closes the record. This is reversed from what I would expect. Whose idea was this and why?
Yeah, it's a bit weird, isn't it?
did you just rename the titles, or did that song have to sit in the middle, but it was the second half of
no,
the song?
No, the Part 1 came first, and then Part 2. It's basically, I had almost too many ideas for a song, so it became, I don't know, I wanted it to... It then very much became two songs. This is not very clear as an answer. But I kind of, with Weight of Living Part 1, I think it's a bit more optimistic than Weight of Living Part 2. And so I kind of wanted to end the album on a lighter note.
Right.
With a bit of optimism.
It sounds almost like, because I mean, it closes half the record. And Icarus could almost be like if this was vinyl, the opening, like it's got a nice intro that it could be the second side. Was that kind of the thought process at all or no?
Yeah, we wanted it to sort of almost feel like a bit of an interlude and then to sort of restart again. Mm. It's a hard decision because it's our first album. We had more songs than we wanted to put on the album, and it was the actual process of picking the track listing and what songs we're going to make it and weren't was, I found, really difficult.
Did those, like, Flaws and Icarus go back really far, right? Mm. So did those two were those always had to be on the record, well, even though they were kind of out there already?
I mean, I remember that being a point of, there was a time where, and it's interesting now chatting to other bands who have had the same experience of us of having songs that have been out for a while before their album was released, that I think everyone goes through, well, we went through a phase of being like, all right, well, let's not put on any of the early singles and try to keep the album completely new. Because kind of for your fans, you want, people that like your music, you want to give them something new. I like, you know, from as a music fan, like when you get an album, you want to hear 12 new tracks.
Mm.
So we were kind of quite reluctant to put all those songs on. But then at the same time, I think that's potentially quite narrow-minded because I think you have to kind of hope that when you release your album, you're going to be reaching more people than you already
seems
have.
To have happened with Bad Blood, which I think.
Yeah.
Yeah,
no. That worked out well.
Which is weird. So I think we sort of kind of had that debate and then we're like, well, no, this should be a collection of what we think is the best stuff we've done up till now, anticipating that hopefully more than just the small fan base that we already have might maybe get into it.
So. Right. What was the fan base? The fans of Montreal pronounce the name correctly? Because it's a French word, Bastille. Yes. And I keep hearing all these US interviews, Bastille, Bastille.
We pronounce it wrong. We pronounce it wrong.
You pronounce it wrong, too?
It's definitely Bastille, but we our English and our French accents are appalling, so we just kind of...
gave up.
But you won't do the full L like the Americans either, because of your accents. Like, they'll say Bastille.
All right. We should Bastille.
Bastille, yeah. You get the EO. I mean, I like that. Anyway, nuances of the language. I mean,
it was interesting for us when we first left England and did some gigs in Europe, and everyone sort of looked horrified at our pronunciation. But, you know, at least we're aware of it. If we were kind of just completely ignorant, that would be bad.
Right.
We're kind of knowingly terrible.
Kyle, you don't. I was looking through the thing. You don't play on the record. So, what was the hardest thing to learn? What was the most difficult song to learn, or what was the easiest song to learn? What?
The hardest was These Streets.
How come?
You have to do it's like Rain Man impression.
I can't really. To explain it would just take too long and be so boring for people who don't play keyboard.
Fair enough.
But didn't your like classical piano teacher is like a concert pianist? I'd never be able to play it.
Basically, like because like I sort of wanted to get up to scratch, so I got this like classically trained like music. Extraordinaire student sort of person who's trying to teach me, and he was like, and I was trying to explain to him what I was playing and how I could sort of make it easier. He was like, I don't know anyone who could even play that. And so maybe me not being classically trained helped, because, and so it, like in These Streets, if you see any videos or whatever, that's the chorus where I'm sort of playing and I go, and the chorus stops. I'm like, oh, wicked.
Can you open your eyes now? Because there was a long time where you couldn't.
I couldn't open my eyes for the first.
Because he has to play, like
offbeat
something quite sounds. Difficult in this hand, an offbeat rhythm there, and sing backing vocals all at the same time. Because of the way that a lot of the album was recorded, it was sort of pieced together, and a lot of the parts. Well, you know, they'll be like with the drums as well. There'll be kind of lots and lots of counter rhythms that aren't necessarily intended for one. Well, not intended. They're intended for one person to play, but they weren't kind of thinking about it. When you're just programming stuff, you don't necessarily think, oh, one day someone's got to play this live. So
turns out.
Yeah. So what did you think when you came on board?
Well, I play on think half of it.
Yeah.
Bad Blood, the title track, was the hardest one for me. Because that was programmed drums, it's mainly kind of hip-hop-y and that sort of stuff, so like a real kit wouldn't have sounded right. However, there's two different bass drum sounds in it, and I've got to do some, it's, again, a bit of a Rain Man sort of vibe. You've got to just try and not think about what you're doing. If you do that, oh God, how are limbs doing this in this particular order, then it all just kind of falls apart.
Sometimes Woody, like, when we're doing new stuff, you see him, like, his brain trying to work out how the hell he's going to do it all. And sometimes he goes into a slight meltdown as well.
Well, because we don't know, because we usually stand in the same circle shouting.
No,
hit this one now. Which is probably not the best way to
do it. Yeah, no, I think that is the best way.
We're making rehearsals sound really fun.
Shout at each other.
It's kind of a nurturing process, really. Yeah.
I feel pretty cocky. All my bass lines are well easy.
But you play keys on the record too, right?
I don't play on the record, I play live. I lied to Dan. I joined, like, when I first met Dan. I really wanted to do it. Like, it was the first time in ages that I'd seen a band that I actually really wanted to be in. I was like, I've got to get this gig. Mm. And so I went down to meet the guys and stuff, and I was like, oh, we kind of need someone who can sing. I'd never sung before. I was like, yeah, I'm a pretty good singer. Like, never sang in my life. And he's like, and also, if you could play a bit, kids, I was like, yeah, play that too. And so the day after, I went and spent £50 on an Argos keyboard.
It's
still the only keyboard I've ever owned. I'm at home right
now. Only the finest.
He'll never know. He knows now. I just gave let the cat out of the bag.
It's all good. The live show, everyone can play really well. I've seen you guys, so it's awesome.
Thanks.
Anyway, I don't know where this is going.
It's all smoke and mirrors, really. But yeah.
Touring with Muse and playing, like, a lot of these songs would lend themselves to those amazing stadiums. Like, song, like, Laura Palmer I could just feel it blowing one of those places up. So what was it like touring with them? What did you learn from them as performers, given that this is, like, the first world tour?
I mean, I think it's interesting. It was a really interesting experience, but we couldn't really feel... I think in a lot of the situations we're in at the moment, we feel kind of... I don't know, not unworthy in a sort of like self-flagellating way, but more like, I don't know, that we're so at the beginning of what we're doing, and then to go on the tour with someone like Muse, and they're like 5-6 albums in, and they've got giant robots and flamethrowers and fireworks and lasers and
floating
everything.
Light bulbs with acrobats coming out the bottom.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And then there's us, and we're like, we've got a keyboard.
Dan jumps around a bit.
Yeah. It was kind of, I don't know, and I guess that's the point of being a support band, like, you know, you're meant to be new and nothing like, but it was really interesting. I think there's something so, in a good way, so dramatic and over the top about what they do. And I think that's kind of, when you like fully embrace the stadium show, that's kind of the route that you go down. But
what I thought was quite funny, we just on that, just before doing those gigs, had our new like backdrop thing made, which we thought was the biggest thing we'd ever seen. It's like enormous, and then we put it up in the stadium. It's
like a bit like 120 to the background.
Yeah. Someone put a post-it on the back of the stage.
We're like, oh, it doesn't look so good here.
That's amazing.
But it was, yeah, I mean, it was just so way beyond anything we'd ever done before, and in terms of scale, and yeah, they were really nice guys, and you know, they're like one of Woody's favourite bands growing up. So it was kind of, it was an amazing thing to be able
Woody
to
do. Has a collection of these photographs, took little photos of their face and put them on, and he wanted to get them signed. We're like, dude, that's
just weird. You tried to get them to sign it on the chest.
Let
of the
them defend themselves, hang on.
Will gets bored in interviews, so for the past 6 months he's been making up these salacious rumours and lies about me. So apparently I know the names of all their kids, I don't. I've been caught going through their bins.
It's funny seeing Woody get defensive over it, because it's so clearly not
but
true.
But if you say it enough times...
Poetry,
apparently I've done fan art as well, I've got tattoos on my back.
All right.
That one's easy to disprove. Yeah. You just have to get your muscular...
All right, well, this is getting weird. We do something called five questions. Five quick questions, one word answers, everyone can answer. Road or studio?
Road.
Road.
I'm very much part of the road.
Yeah. Well, maybe road. The next record, maybe.
Definitely the next
record. I know.
I don't know.
Studio Road.
Yeah, both. It's hard, they're so different.
Lennon or McCartney?
Oh.
Lennon.
McCartney.
Ooh.
There's the one. when you hear a song, what usually hits you first? Lyrics, melody, or rhythm?
Rhythm.
Melody.
Oh, rhythm.
If someone's never heard Bastille before, I'm going to pronounce it in French.
Good.
What song do they start with?
The first one.
Bad Blood.
The Silence.
Icarus.
What's the first one?
Pompeii. Yeah, I'd say Flaws.
In one word, Bastille.
French.
Bastille.
Us.
Band.
you picked all the best words. All of them.
All of the words.
Literally
the
all of the English language you've chosen so eloquently. Music.
Thanks, guys.